Yeah, all right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you. My name is Shakil Ahmed. I'm on Daknam Shantunu. You can call me whichever you want. And I will be the moderator for today's session on, it's called Walking the Talk and Engaging Young People. And I'm saying this while I'm sitting down. All right. Of course, when we're talking about youth engagement, let me clarify. Engagement hotche na ajke. Right? There's no wedding or engagement happening, right? In the spirit of transparency, that wasn't my joke, right? Like a youth told me yesterday, and it depends on how you define youth, right? Because according to the UN definition, I don't belong to the youth category, right? 15 to 24, but thanks to the Bangladesh's national youth policy, this is officially my final year of being the youth, being youthful from 18 to 35 years old. However, of course, it depends on how you define youth, right? Like, there's some people who are thinking that youth may not be necessarily based on your age range, but on the idea of what it is to be youthful, or on having a youthful mindset, such as being curious, being open to ideas, cracking lame jokes, no, not that, being in search of purpose, being creative and brave in taking new risks, having a sense of possibility and optimism for the future, and being brave and adaptive. And of course, as we've heard yesterday, youth are not just the future, right? They are the present. And we have seen the data, we've heard about the weak signals, and honestly, they felt like strong signals to me, right? And this demographic is definitely instrumental in shaping a prosperous, productive Bangladesh and the world. Now, this demographic is potentially both influential and influenceable. Yeah, on one hand, this demographic can be bold in raising their voice and thus influential in advocating various issues, like ranging from climate change, like the traffic protests, the VAT issue, social movements, movements on gender violence, the rights of garments workers. I mean, there's a whole range of issues. And even throughout history, right? Even in February when we celebrated the language movement, or even independence, like youth were always a great part of like raising their voice. The inclusion of youth voices in policy making or decision making provides a fresh perspective, and not just because of their lack of fear of being authentic, but also given their experience as youth. On the other hand, this demographic is also in a critical state in their lives as they seek purpose and meaning, and thus they're vulnerable to forces that supposedly provide purpose or meaning to the lives of youth who are otherwise ignored, ostracized, unemployed, or even disenfranchised. These forces could very well be divisive. They can influence youth into being ambassadors of divisive rhetoric or into performing acts of violence in the name of whether it be politics or religion or anything. So given this rapid change and this complex world and technologies and all that, today's youth are also very adaptive in handling these platforms. But given the increase in exposure to information and experiences through technologies, today's youth are always constantly being bombarded with opinions and thoughts, right? And this may result in distraction and also in youth being actually pretty much confused, right? Like, which sources do I actually look at? So given these dynamics, how are youth currently being engaged in Bangladesh and the world, right? A top-down pedagogical approach, like if I keep on lecturing, that's not gonna work. But given their curious and critical minds, how should we actually engage the youth today, right? And these are some of the topics that we're gonna explore. This is not gonna be like a panel where we're just gonna speak and we're gonna have some Q&A, we're gonna be doing a workshop, right? And so we need all of your participation in this room. So I'm blessed to be in the presence of five esteemed panelists over here. I'll introduce them one by one, and they'll talk about a bit about what their question is. So the first, could I get the slide, please? Yeah. Oh, thank you. Is it on? Thank you. Yeah, it's always like switch it on or off. So Osama Noor is the co-founder of Youth Opportunities, and the question that he'll be exploring in his group is, how do we create access for youth to engage in existing opportunities? So I'll give it to Osama and Noor for a bit.
Hello. So thank you, Shakil. Assalamu alaikum and good morning, everyone. I hope you guys all had good night's sleep, all right? So as Shakil said, that the young people in Bangladesh played a very important role in various issues, which is very important for a nation, which is language movement, liberation war, and recently we have seen the PAT quota reformation, we have seen the road safety movement, but a lot of young people, half of the entire population in Bangladesh are the young population. And 8 crore of the young people are using internet. They have high-speed internet connection. They have 4G connection. But unfortunately, the lack of digital literacy, we have seen the rumors are spreading. The fake news are spreading. They're engaging in different, violating the social media. And that leads into a big problem for us. And so I think it's very one of the main issues. We should engage young people to spread positive news and also real news as well. Because we have a lot of opportunities and to engage themselves. There are a lot of programs that are happening from the private sectors and from the public sectors as well. They're offering different types of programs to develop themselves, to develop professionally, to develop personally as well, and also to develop the organization. There are a lot of accelerated programs. Shagufe is working for engaging young madrasa students. Ashoka is working, Teach for Bangladesh working, CRI working. A lot of organizations are creating a lot of opportunities, but they are not connecting. I think we should focus on the digital literacy. We should engage young people how to use digital platform. We should have more awareness about this, because a large number of young people are Bangladeshis, young people, and they are the power station. I think Bangladesh is having one of the most powerful resource, which is the young people, is the Bangladesh. I think it's very important to analyzing these issues, because these lack of digital literacy, it leads into a different problems. It can be educational, it can be a national, it can be a personal as well. Thank you.
Thank you. So the next speaker is Yashveer Singh. He's the director of Youth Ventures in South Asia for Ashoka, and on the topic that he'll be exploring in his group is, how can youth create opportunities for themselves, and what are systemic changes needed to do that?
Hello, good morning. Am I audible? Yes. So I think, firstly, congratulations to the wonderful organizing team, because I think this is one event where I'm seeing where the theme is about young people, and there are so many young people in the room. Otherwise, I think a lot of conferences I go to, they talk and discuss about children and youth, and there are hardly any children and youth in the room. So firstly, my congratulations to all the organizers. I think they definitely deserve a big round of applause. So thanks, guys. So I come here to represent an organization called Ashoka, and we are a 39-year-old institution, which started in 1980 supporting social entrepreneurs. So our role was, we will go to a country and identify leading social entrepreneurs and support them, and we have been doing it from last 39 years. But what I'm going to talk today is more around some of the insights which have emerged while working with these social entrepreneurs. So one of the most important and powerful findings of working with these social entrepreneurs have been, firstly, I think most of them started their journey to become change makers quite early on in their life. So we did an internal research, and we found more than 2/3 of our Ashoka fellows started as teenagers to create organizations or launch initiatives, etc. So which was a very powerful insight, that some of the leading change makers start young, and change really starts young. The second important is, I think out of almost around 4,000 Ashoka fellows, 25% of them work with children and youth. And by and large, everyone believes that the biggest influencer for young people are young people themselves. And I think their single most powerful insight is, how do we put children and young people in charge to share or to shape future of their entire generation? And I was talking to, I think, recently I was in US where I was talking to a bunch of young people and I was like, where do you spend most of your time? And not surprisingly, they said Instagram. And I was trying to understand who do they follow, and most of the role models were, again, young people. So I think one thing which I am really passionate about, and I'm going to talk in one of the sessions or the mini workshops, is how do we put young people in charge so that they can influence other young people, and we create a co-leadership movement along with young people rather than just talking at young people. So that's what I'm going to, I think, share in my session. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Yashveer. So then we have Shagufe Hossain coming up. So Shagufe Hossain is the founder and project director of Leaping Boundaries, and she'll be exploring what cultural dispositions or values should youth or people working with youth inhabit for further youth engagement, and of course, what sort of initiatives will make that happen.
Thank you, Shakil. That was a very insightful introduction, and I think we've gotten a very good feel of what the youth in Bangladesh kind of look like. I actually started my career here at BRAC, so it's good to be back. To say a little bit about my organization, I work with what we believe is one of the most marginalized communities in Bangladesh, female madrasa students. And we're focused on increasing their visibility on platforms where they're underrepresented. We do this in two ways. One is we make their stories accessible to a wider audience. We engage them in art and poetry and technology, and then we make sure they have access to platforms where they're underrepresented. The second way we do this is we function as a training ground for university students between 18 to 22 years old who become practitioners of what we call authentic leadership. The authentic leadership model rests on four values: integrity, compassion, curiosity, and courage. We believe that's what makes you authentic. And the way they practice this is they first connect with themselves. So there's a lot of, during our reflection session, something that came up was about self-awareness and how important that is. And that's an aspect that we often leave out. So we want to focus a lot on that. The second pillar, sort of, is connecting with the other. So not just communicating, but forming connections, authentic relationships. And the third is what we call us together, which is how we together build a better world. So these 18 to 22 year olds first go through a training program, and then they are immersed in communities for about 3 months where they identify a problem that affects girls in madrasas, and they come up with a solution and implement it. The question that I'm supposed to be exploring today is, what are some of the cultural dispositions or values that youth or people working with the youth inhabit or should inhabit for further youth engagement? And I have nothing to say on this. There are certain values that I practice, there are certain values that we as an organization practice, but I am very interested and curious to know what comes up out of the room. So thank you. Looking forward to this discussion further.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Right, after this we have Radwan. And the question, and of course Radwan Mujib Siddiq is from, he's a trustee and from the Center for Research and Information. And the question that he will be discussing is, how can youth be further engaged and connected with the government and private sector so that youth have a voice in the policies that influence them? And of course, what will make this happen?
Thank you, Shakil. Good morning, everyone, and thanks, BRAC, for having me here. I'd like to quickly start off by just talking about protests, because it came up a couple of times. You know, responsibly protesting is a healthy part of any democratic society. However, young people shouldn't have to take to the streets every time they want their voices heard. And I think this is part of the question that we're hoping to address here today. And it's also part of what my organization, CRI, tries to do. We want to bring young people closer to the policymaking and decision-making cycle through a couple of ways. The first thing is we try and promote an understanding of government and policymaking amongst young people. It's very important here to make a distinction between politics and government. And this is what we also try and present. Politics, I think, in Bangladesh is debated ad nauseum. You know, we're fairly obsessed with politics. I don't think you're never more than three sentences away from a political discussion. And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, that's healthy and that's good. But it shouldn't cloud young people's judgment of what government actually is. You know, politics, you elect people to represent you, but what happens after that? What are they doing in parliament? What are the kind of policy debates they're shaping? And who are the actual policymakers? People sitting in government, there are other stakeholders. We have the private sector. We, of course, have specialists. We have academics. So we try and get this message across to young people as well, that let's sit together. Let's look at the policies that really affect you. And then let's try and understand how these policies are made so that you're in a better position to hold your public representatives and your government accountable. We came about this kind of model by first we thought, okay, we're going to put young people in a room with decision makers and influential people and then just start a conversation. But we actually found that these discussions were not always that productive. They stopped after a certain point. So after that, we kind of went back and we rejigged our model and we started doing what we called, what we like to call policy circle studies. So we sit around and then, you know, we'll pick out bits of policy and we'll ask young people, what do you think about this? Do you think this represents you? Do you think this helps you in your everyday life? And if you would like to see any changes, what would they be? And also, how do you hold, again, government accountable? If a government is saying, we're youth focused, we're sport focused, we're looking at people with disabilities, are they walking the walk? Are they spending enough money there? Are they making sure things are implemented? So it's a two-way process for us. We want to encourage a deeper understanding of government and policymaking, and also we want to put young people in front of these influential decision makers. I'm very interested to find out from the sort of collective wisdom of this room how we can institutionalize some of these ideas that we've been working on at CRI through events and our youth platform, Young Bangla. But again, we need to make these things much more systematic so that, like I said, you know, young people don't feel compelled to go onto the streets when they feel like there are decisions being made that affect them adversely. So looking forward to a productive session today.
Thank you. Thank you so much, right, for that. And finally, we have Maliha Fawzia from Teach for Bangladesh. She's the program director of Dhaka. And the question that she'll be exploring is, what can parents and school-based educators do to build key mindsets and skills in youth? And of course, what do we do in order for that to happen?
Thank you, Shakil. I think what we have learned yesterday to figure out that how we have a huge generation of youth and our skills, mindset that we are building all together from school, college, and university does not really connect with what the 21st century is looking for oftentimes. And also thinking about that oftentimes we also separate curriculum and pedagogy from skills and mindset that we want to build in our schools, college, and universities for our youth. So thinking about, just think for a while, thinking about that how we actually help our students to understand that self-worth is very much different from your grades, that your grades are a result of your efforts, not your self-worth. And building that mindset among young people, that how are we actually practicing that at home, at school, and everywhere? What consciousness, what critical thinking ability we are building through our education system and in our practice of day-to-day life. And that's what really I am passionate to talk about and to engage more and get our collective learning together. Looking forward to that.
Thank you. All right, so thank you, Maliha. Thank you all. All right, so to get into, obviously this is a recap, I'll come back to this. So what's the norms for this workshop, right? So it's gonna be a solutions-oriented workshop. I see, like, are there four whiteboards in the room or are there five? Okay, I don't see the fifth one. There's one behind that? Okay, cool, thank you. All right, so the duration for the workshop will be 20 to 25 minutes. I'll give you a time check. Of course, anyone in this room can gravitate towards any topic that they want to, right? And of course, you will walk to the facilitator or zone of your interest. In your groups, you discuss the theme, the existing gaps and opportunities, and you generate solutions. by the end, your facilitator should be able to present at least one existing solution, at least one emerging solution. That means the solution exists in small pockets, but is not mainstream, and at least one radical solution. Yeah? And feel free to rank some of your solutions in your group based on the group's preferences, right? Because sometimes we might come up with a laundry list of solutions, but it's good to also get to know from the group like what are preferred solutions as well. And solutions can be technical, adaptive, systemic, right? Yeah, feel free, solutions you want to like suggest. And of course, I'll warn you when it's the 10 minutes left, 5 minutes left, 1 minute is left. And of course, may the force be with you. Before we do that, I will just say, so over here, we have number one, we'll have Osama, right? Over to number two, we'll have Yashveer. Number three, we have Shagufe. Then we have Radwan bhai over here. And then we have Maliha over here, yeah? Okay, and I think with that, can we have some music, please? Right? And with the music, you can already start thinking. Let's start walking the walk. Let's walk in the talk, not just talk the talk. Let's walk the talk. All right. Cool. All right. Thank you. Yeah. Can I get the slides back on, please? So we have all the questions.
Det næste stykke musik, ja, jeg ved ikke rigtig, hvordan jeg skal indlede det, uden at sige noget, jeg har sagt rigtig mange gange før. Jo, vi skal faktisk høre verdens bedste filmmusik, intet mindre, i hvert fald ifølge det amerikanske filminstitut, som for nogle år siden lavede en liste, og den her musik kom ind som nummer et.
Oh, really? Oh,
men
okay.
Altså,
oh, wow.
Lad os starte med begyndelsen. George Lucas siger selv, at han havde planlagt det hele.
Wow. So you guys can, if it's a bit crowded, like figure out which space you want to go to. Hey, can we always have that slide in the background? Yeah. creativity. All right, I think we're waiting for Shagufe. Is Shagufe in the house?
Yours seems to be most fully packed. Full house.
But just use your creativity to like whatever way you want. 45, okay. Huh? Yeah, it's fine. Yeah.
So how much time we have? It's already 10 to
end the whole session, 10:45. So we take four minutes, five minutes. Four and a half minutes
for each.
4 minutes.
Let's reverse the order.
Okay. Reverse the order, yeah. All right, sure. All right. Thank you. We do have a whiteboard coming up. Thank you, sir, for helping out with this. Okay, if you have like the rest of the room, just please seated. Then we can just start sharing some of the findings and insights that have come out of this this workshop, or what should I say, like a series of workshops happening at the same time. Okay, firstly we'll have we'll reverse the order, right? We reverse the order, so maybe we have Maliha, Fawzia, if you could share what can parents and school-based educators do to build key mindsets and skills in youth?
Thank you, Shakil. Please help me with keeping the time, because my group came up with a lot of solutions. So starting with using some existing practice that we already have in some of the places. For example, in our group, we talked about BRAC schools where parents and teachers come together and talk about the students and what mindset to build together. And also, we talked about Light of Hope, where they also have parents' time, where parents come and co-create situations for students and also teach. And for emerging solution, we had some of the practice that is already going as well, but not really widespread in our country, like story time. How can teachers actually use different stories to bring aspirations and all those skills that we want to build in our students? For example, critical thinking, resilience, empathy, that can be really easily built through storytelling. And also focusing on soft skills in building students than just thinking of technical solutions and technical changes. So curriculum reform was an interesting debate. So we think that preparing the soil before reforming curriculum and asking for curriculum reform is super important. How are we preparing our teachers, our parents, our community members actually to use and implement the curriculum, then demanding for curriculum reform? So how are we actually engaging that practice among us and building that practice to have a conversation, co-creation of the projects in between parent, teacher, and students, where three of them come together and co-create projects and understand each of the stakeholders more in depth? And yeah, we had a radical solution for this, is like happiness curriculum. So how can we also include that for our students to understand them more, to make them feel that like you are part of it and your effort, and we are empathetic towards you, and we understand you, that what you are going through, and then just imposing our thoughts as parents and educators, like we think you should be doing this and that. That makes them go through a longer run when they fail in university entrance exam. How we perceive that, how we think of that, like you not getting into one particular university, you are not a failure as a student. So perception of parents and teachers and educators, I think preparing that, that's what my group came up with. So I think in relation to that, what Teach for Bangladesh does is very much connected. Our fellows are fresh graduate who works in our fellowship and gets into the classroom where they actually build such kind of mindset and try to practice that, to engage with students, to build that you are in our classroom and not only to learn the subject knowledge, but how to build that skill so that you can become the next generation. And also to understand, as an organization, we see that to build such skill in our classroom, our youth needs also certain kind of cognitive skill, social-emotional skill, and also professional skills that we as an organization also try to build in our fellowship. So So yeah, over to you, Shakil. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for sharing sharing that information, yeah. And yeah, it was interesting to listen, hearing about even a happiness curriculum as well. All right, if you can had Radwan share what came up in your session.
Sure. If you saw me squinting at this, it's because my handwriting's so bad, I can't read it myself. True story, I had to pay to get one of my final exam scripts at university typed up because the examiner couldn't read it. All right, so our group was focused on how to institutionalize a mechanism for young people to have a voice in policymaking. We had a very active group, lots of good suggestions, and a very good discussion. So here we just scribbled out some of the things that came up as it went along. I'll just read them out quickly and then read out the sort of clusters that we put them under. Making sure that the voice for the most marginalized are heard. So specifically from Save the Children, we had, you know, adolescent girls, and then we also had the question of ultra poor. If are you really thinking about policy if you're, you know, worried about putting two meals on the table a day? Mental health and well-being of students that we're engaging. It was kind of like, well, you know, we first need to see how well equipped they are to give policy decisions, but during the course of our discussion, we also decided that this is something that should come up in any kind of meaningful conversation, so that mental health well-being would also become a policy area with a lot of focus. Policy awareness, outreach came out a lot, information gap, explaining policy better to people, better to young people, and making sure that there's some kind of way of getting their feedback on it. Better coordination amongst youth-oriented, youth-focused organizations. Even in our group, we had three or four different organizations working on roughly the similar areas. Like me and Syed, we know each other, we know what our organizations do, but I have to admit, we haven't really worked together yet. So this is something that we can all improve on. Technology. We have the founder of the 10-Minute School here, so online tutorials on policy or key policy areas for young people. And it's not only young people, I keep on saying young people, like older people don't always know what's going on in the policy cycles as well. So we can broaden that, you know, anyone who wants to know. And policy input to formulation and evidence-based lobbying, which is what we talked about a little bit before, that it's not just enough to tell young people, okay, tell us what you think about policy. A little bit of preparatory work has to go into that. So that roughly comes into three or four categories. Capacity development, a word I cannot read, / access, coordination, and sustainability. So these are some of the kind of emerging areas that we thought needed addressing. So for the solutions, the existing one, which we got a bit of heckling from an unnamed member of the audience, which is the National Youth Policy Draft already has a provision for a civil society government coordination group. And if this could be made operational, it might solve some, or it can address some of the issues of coordination that we talked about. So not very exciting maybe, but you know, could be useful amongst the existing. Emerging, the policy forums and discussions that are already existing, we need to plug them into the place where this really all takes place, is Parliament. Could there be a space in Parliament where legislators actually listen to policy discussions from young people, and whether they could even throw it out there to saying, you know, this is a policy discussion, we want actual solutions from young people or, you know, the general population. And also really, you know, there's this kind of, we put policy out on the website, so that's consultation, but like really do that properly in this, you know, not just a kind of token gesture. Radical local government internships, where young people are actually given projects to implement. So it's not just go see what's being done. Given responsibility, and then they're also accountable for what they're doing. It might not sound that radical, but it is, trust me, trying to get the government to do internships. So That's pretty good. And then we had another great one, an example from Copenhagen, youth advisors for ministries. We should have one radical, but I think I'm going to merge that into one. So thanks to the group, and thank you, everyone, for listening.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So next we have Shagufe, if you could like share.
Thank you. My board is actually at the back, so I'm just going to read from whatever notes I have. We in our group tackled a two-part question. One is, what cultural dispositions or values should young people be working with you, or people working with youth inhabit for further youth engagement? So we've identified in our group three main values. There were some other ones as well. The first is self-awareness, getting in touch with your own set of values. The second is compassion. And the third is taking responsibility for your own actions, so ownership. Those are the three values that we talked about. And in terms of what initiatives that can be taken to shape such a culture, we talked about, two solutions, really. The first part of the solution is a research that can occur in the form of either policy circles or human-centered design. The research has to be inclusive of all groups and communities, including ethnic minorities, sexual minorities, gender minorities, people with disability, people with psychosocial disabilities. In short, it just has to include everybody. This can lead to a soft skills program. Part of this is we were asked to think of solutions in terms of existing solutions, emerging solutions, and radical solutions. So this is partly existing. There are many soft skills programs that are in the country right now, but the solution, I think, exists in parts. There are solutions that are just soft skills programs, and then there are just research programs. But we could do with a solution, which is, I think, emerging. I believe BRAC is doing something along these lines as well, where the two are kind of integrated. The soft skills program is kind of based off on research. Somebody in the group said something very interesting about how the solution usually lies in the problem. So what we're identifying as the problem group, so to say, the youth, will come up with the solutions themselves. And the radical solution that was proposed was a kind of a SWAT team that launches into action every time that there is an existential crisis, which we've seen a lot in the recent times. So I don't know how this would work. I can't even begin to conceptualize it. But if we could maybe have a group of people who are like first responders when there is a crisis that happens that's related to an existential crisis. For instance, when there is the Quota movement that happened or the road safety movement that happened. As soon as these crises starts to emerge, if there was a group from within the community, the youth group, that would come up and do something to kind of curb it before it took on these mass volumes. That could be a radical solution. Again, I don't know how this is going to be materialized, but it would be interesting to see. So those are the solutions.
Thank you. And I can slowly see a lot of alignment coming up with some of the solutions as well. So Yashveer, yeah. Okay.
I think my group was quite radical. And I can hear their laughs also. So while I speak, I think it's their voices which I'm presenting. So I think as I said that we came out with a lot of ideas, and I think those ideas were at different layers and different levels. As you can see, although it's tough to read, but I think there were aspects like how do we, because I think the whole question which we were trying to explore was how do young people help other young people? And one thing which came across very clearly was that there were different levels at which young people can intervene. One at a direct engaging with the young people level, secondly changing the institutions and so on and so forth, and thirdly the large part was around mindset. because I think a lot of times and all the people who were there as part of the group felt that there is a huge mindset challenge which exists in the society, where I think what we believe is that wisdom comes as you grow older and as you have more and more experience. So I think just switching it or changing that frame in itself was a huge challenge. So just to go through a couple of ideas which emerged was that young people need to pursue their own ideas. They need to have mentorship in a way which is non-interfering or mentorship which is more like an alliance with adults. They also need to focus on giving them that I can mindset and I can attitude, because a lot of times it's not a matter of skills, but it's also a matter of that belief that we can do it. And I think one point, a very interesting point, which also came was around, it's not just about skills, it's equally important to give stress on the values also, because both go very hand in hand together. Now, in the framework which was given, I think there were a lot of solutions which emerged, and in all three categories, existing, emerging, and radical. Existing was, I think, mostly students' union and student clubs at schools and colleges level is one way by which I think young people are already trying to empower young people. But I think there was some discussion around how that structure can be more strengthened. Similarly, I think there was an example of Scholastica and how that as a institution is giving power to ideas of young people, which came as one of the existing solutions. In emerging solutions, I think there were a couple of international. I think one was Youth Solving Youth, which was an example of South Africa, where I think young people are given the opportunity to work on one social change idea and one business idea. And I think then also it's a very different kind of learning in both the experiences. And in radical, as I said, our group was quite radical, so we came out with a lot of radical ideas. And I think one example was in Italy, there is a boys and girls town where I think it's being managed and governed by young people. So one of the recommendations which came as part of a radical idea was also that how can we have maybe government departments, at least some of them, run by young people, or how can we increase the representation quite, I think, what we heard in our last session as well. And I think overall the emerging theme was that we need to, I think, give spaces to young people where they can express, where they can ideate, where they can work in teams, and that's what is going to, I think, break a lot of this silos and this current status quo, which is putting young people down and really not looking them as equal partners in this journey. So I think big round of applause for my group. I think they did a great job. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you, and finally we have Osama.
Thank you. Our topic was how we can create access for the young people to engage in existing opportunity. So existing opportunity, it means we have a lot of opportunities exist for the young people. But the young people are complaining they are not finding the opportunities. So here we are discussed a lot about it and find some amazing solutions. Our team was very engaged. I would like to request to come up on the stage our two group members to share some points as well. They have participated in a group. Yeah, come. So let me share the first solution, which is we should have a common platform for all kinds of information, because we have a lot of existing opportunities. Like BWELS is offering leadership courses. The IMAN is teaching a lot of life learning, life hacks, and a lot of educational content. And Shagufe is doing a lot of stuff. Ashoka is doing, CRI is doing a lot of program, Teach for Bangladesh Fellowship. A lot of opportunities are providing by the educational institution, NGOs, government, and there are a lot of opportunity for SDG field, A2I, a lot of fields. Because it's not in a single page. If we can find all the information in a single platform, that would be very helpful for our young people. So we should have a common platform for all kinds of information, please.
Okay, so we also talked about how can we engage rural people, and then we talked about how can we set platforms for mentorship for youth. It means government schools, degree colleges, how we can have access to these sort of platforms where the institutions, they are going to tell like what sort of skills they are searching for, and from a very young level, those skills are instilling in the education system. We also talked about like educational reform as well, because there's a gap in what sort of skills we are searching for and what other opportunities there. So that's why we came up with inclusiveness and also like lifelong learning skills.
So the things that we face, the problem we face that about the digital learning, most of the, we think that they should know, most of the, we assume that everybody have the mobile and they should know, they know the digital, use the mobile. But use of mobile is very important. How to use the app is important. And when the smartphone, everybody maybe have, but they don't have that capacity of the smartphone to download the app. So we are discussing on this, and we make a solution that we can have send the paper and that use the paper for that, and we can do the make it accessibility for all, for person with disabilities as well as ethnic, to reach the ethnic communities is very important, and also collaboration with the public private sector as well as the we just discussed that intersectoral institutional, those who are working in the same same project.
Thank you. And our the access to information is a human rights. I think it's very important to know what's the opportunity actually waiting for the young people, and they can access those information and transform into a success. So accessibility is very, very important, and intersectoral collaboration, like we can partnership with newspapers, so that we have a partnership with Daily Star. Elite Up is here, so we spread all this information, top opportunities through the newspaper, so that they, we can reach who doesn't have internet connection or mobile phone, so they can also access all this information. So we have to inclusive platform through digital and the physical. It's a digital, right? Someone said from our team. So that's all from our team. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, and no, I mean, and thank you for everyone's work in putting this up. I think what we'd like to do after this is actually create even a blog article, an article of where we'll document all the different solutions, so that we can share it among them, and maybe you guys can follow up and keep collaborating. Yeah, I mean, definitely. Like, if each of you, like from your own organizations, if you can take some of the key solutions forward, then this will be really helpful in mobilizing. And of course, like BRAC and Rolls can also be a player. And yeah, so the idea, yeah. So obviously, like, I mean, the saying is that don't just talk the talk; you have to like walk the talk. And on that note, thank you, and hopefully, like we have a great session ahead.